culture and language living different marks, and we can during the last quarter century, actually the entire circle of the process of transculturation took place, and that's what I'm going to briefly over. Well, actually the Russian media and linguistic landscapes are pretty unique with regard to food-related programs and vocabulary. Maybe you won't believe that, but in 1992 there were only 5 TV channels in Russia. Yeah, 5 channels, and 0 cooking programs existed at that moment. That's what they started with. There was another interesting thing which projected itself in real life. Very few foreign cuisine restaurants served customers, probably in a dozen of locations in major cities like Moscow and St. Petersburg. So there were no places to use food-related vocabulary. Also, you should remember that after the Soviet Union, the supermarket shelves contained too few products that needed cooking or complex recipes, etc., etc. A quarter of a century apart, in 2016, every TV channel of more than 50 broadcast all over the country carries at least one weekly cooking and food-related show. And at least 50% of them are foreign. So this is a major undertaking in terms of the translation experience. Actually, I have the Moscow School of Audiovisual Translation, and we teach people how to translate the program. That's why this research came to life. Because we had to see how the whole process originated and how it developed. Because we went from 0 to thousands of hours of cooking programming with all the latest vocabulary. It's not just, you can't just name a dish. You have at least to explain, like our colleagues, what cultural attributes are behind them. The number of restaurants serving foreign cuisine is about 12,000 all over the country. It's actually from less than 100 to 12,000. They are present all over the country, and their number has doubled over the last 30 months. Well, it's actually an exponential growth. The starting point of this research is that before 1922, eating out hadn't been a cultural phenomenon in Russia. It's really so easy. There was no tradition of eating out. It had developed in the last 25 years as a result of the transculturation process. People actually adopted eating out habits from what they saw on screens and TV series and other programs, etc., etc. Italian, Latin American, American, etc., etc. It's a unique experience. It wasn't that way before 1917, 100 years ago. But during the last years of the Soviet rule, actually it was actually flattened up, the culture of eating out. Even, I should say, in the 50s, under the Stalin rule, it was not that way. What happened actually in the 70s, the culture of eating out went up. And in the specific case of Russia, we adopted a lot of language from outside sources. A lot of language. It was actually the translators who drove that process. I will show to you a chart which will help you understand why translators actually were the headliners of these trans and male culturation experiences. And because in the specific case of Russia, it happened because these sources were the media ones, and in particular, audiovisual program. Actually, we have a unique chance. We had a unique chance of analyzing the linguistic transculturation process in its entirety, and layer by layer. And it happened over a very short period of time. It was not ancient history for most of our translators, because it happened during their lifetime, even if they are 30, 35, it all happened right in front of their eyes. It helped to shape the lingos of entire industry, because the restaurant industry right now uses the lingo, the language, that translators developed over the last 25 years. Lingo is the vernacular of the restaurant business, not the language itself, but the word they use and their cooking, like like in the kitchen. It's all developed during the last 25 years. This is media versus reality. The words are the number of cooking and food-related programs. From 1992, hours of food and cooking-related programs per year. 1992, it was something like 52 or 50 hours per year. And in 2014, we had more than 4,000 hours of food and cooking-related programs. Half of it is foreign. And this is the number of the restaurants. Why I took it as a point, the number of the restaurants? Because these are the places where people use in the menus, in cooking, in ordering food. They use all the notions that are introduced by this program. It also influences household cooking, what women and men cook at home. But this process is harder to be detected. So we decided to analyze the correlation between these two numbers. Actually, the numbers actually follow the economic situation, but it's easy to see that the trend is here. It is important that the growth of the number of restaurants in the early 90s was preceded by the considerable rise of TV in the number of hours of TV programming, cooking shows, by at least 2 years. The outburst of the number of the restaurants in Russia was actually date back to 1994, and the number of programs began to grow in 1992. Actually, it was the preparation, the audience was ready to visit these places to... It coincided with the number of people traveling in Europe, but most of Russians at that period didn't have money to travel abroad. So for them, TV was kind of a window to the world. And linguistically speaking, it was an extended period of consumer exposition to the new vocabulary and notions. The growth of the media presence for cooking programs was a major undertaking in translation and localization in Russia. Most observers in Russia say that actually TV actually drove the development of food and restaurant industries in real life. Because the national cuisines that were offered to the customers actually followed the programs that were demonstrated. For example, wrote a number of programs, a series of programs on Japanese cuisine in 1999 preceded the outburst of sushi chains. It may be the other way around in Italy, for example, but in our country first, very popular programs about Japanese cuisine came to roost. And then we suddenly had a number of sushi shops popping up in every major city in the country. The nascent industries adopted notions, term translations, and entire glossaries that were introduced by translators and translation, audiovisual translators. Actually, we here speak about transculturation and neoculturation as the idea of consequent creation of new cultural phenomena that eating out really was. It was transculturation and it had different phases. Well, let's see what phases it actually went through and what cultures were the driving forces of that process. Well, you remember from where it asserted that there were five phases of the transculturation and neoculturation process: enslavement, compromise, adjustment, self-assertion, and integration. And they are clearly visible in the development of the cooking and food-related glossaries and vocabularies. Enslavement phase, 1992-1998, 6 years, when it was this period that is often referred to as the cultural aggression, because the notions were adopted as foreign ones. And the curve of the growth of the hours of media programming showed much steadier growth than the actual number of restaurants. And linguistically, most of the adopted dish and food names at that period have the following common attribute. First, they remain barbarisms, grammatically and phonetically. end up. They don't have fixed stressed syllables. That's very important because in Russia, when a word is appropriated, it, we have the moving stress which every any syllable may be stressed. But once it is adopted, you have it fixed. In Russia, the words that were adopted at that period don't, even after 20 years, they don't have fixed stressed syllables. You may pronounce them in a different way. And about 15% of the dogs in that period later were replaced during the integration phase in the last 2 years by more localized dish names. At least this happened with the Italian cuisine, which was one of the first comers through the Russian market. And it happened, it's a lot of terms replaced by local equivalents in the last 2 years. These were the cuisines that were the first to be adopted. American, Irish, Italian. These are the three cuisines that first came to the market, and it is, for example, the American cuisine has a lot of terms in Russia that are still foreign to our area. The compromise for example, coleslaw, we don't translate it, it still remains coleslaw.
Wave of the American cuisine, fusion cuisine,
establishment finally of sets of linguistic rules covering the adoption of the new terminology in the sector. At least now we can teach how the new words coming to Russian have to be processed in terms of stresses, in terms of inclination, etc., etc., from any culture. So it starts to be formalized. So this is the integration phase. The Christians, the new Italian, because the Italian Cucinato went under the second wave. Now it has become more of a household word for Russia. Then new French, Japanese, Israel. And the conclusion, the brief overview of the neo-culturation process in the food and cooking related language sectors in Russia showed the certain tendencies which I demonstrated and trend, and which point out that today language is heavily influenced by the media, much more heavily than we previously thought, and the integration of a national culture into the global context underwent the five phases that I mentioned. Thank you.
I'm trying to make a bridge here, trying to connect stuff together. How would you transfer some clusters from the source text to the final text. So that's another point that we haven't really had the time to look into in detail. And of course, it would be interesting to highlight the reaction, different reactions of the receivers in different communities. That's what we sort of hinted at in the concluding section. We have a different impact of different figurative uses in the two versions of video took into that account. It would be interesting to have also sort of experimental kind of study that it would be help to gather information as to kind of access that we can have and the kind of effects that are actually produced on different.
Do you have this stuff in digital form in Cobra?
Yes, it's being expanded.
Right.
So,
I mean, one of the things that people in the Netherlands, for instance, typically do in this kind of research is that they put a PhD student on it. You build a corpus of 100,000 words. You first do the corpus work and then you run the experiments, and that's a PhD thesis. And it would be wonderful to have this stuff with this data because I think it can show all sorts of very, very interesting things. How do you run the experiment?
Are you thinking of brain scanning or?
No. You can ask people to, for instance, think aloud as they watch the film, or you can have them score scales as they watch the film. You can actually tap their sensations in their skin. That requires a little more advanced techniques, but you can do online as opposed to offline. There's various ways in doing this. But it would be great to have this into different communities and see what's happening.
How to translate for some time, because it's
somehow. So people had to be poor, and not only translator, but also customer had to be poor. We had different courses for corporations because people don't understand why you cut the numbers. You cannot read them.
And you have fan suffers too?
Huh?
Do you have fan suffers?
The curse of the industry. It's actually the curse of our industry, fan suffers. Let them all. You see, the thing is that fan suffers produce subs that are 5 lines, 6 lines, 4 lines, because we don't have the standard. Fan suffers are nice people. But they don't have the slightest idea about the standard of the industry. Like subtitles which are 2 frames long, it's unreadable. Subtitles which are 6 lines on the screen. Well, fan suffers, you see, it was a very amusing story. There's a movie which was produced by the National Agency about Putin addressing the international audiences. And it was subtitled. It was subtitled by the people who were actually basically they used to be fan suffers. And we got the president with 5 lines of subtitles in English, Hindi, French, etc., etc. Fan suffers eventually became the hot topic of discussion, how it could happen. Because millions of dollars were invested in the production and distribution of that movie, and we have 5 more words of subtitles all over the space. Also,
ideologically, fan suffers are trying, deliberately trying to give audiences more information. It's a political thing, not
yes.
a political thing. I mean, they're not doing it.
Yes, in our country, they also claim they give to people freedom and choice. I respect them for that.
Самые интересные субтитры в последнее время, которые встречались, это с примечанием.
same speed like you do, discussing what references people have about other cultures, how it is the question of otherness. Before that, it wasn't that way. Everything was the other thing.
So we can expect a Russian Jamie Oliver. Russian MasterChef. We have Russian MasterChef? MasterChef.
Yes, we do. We do have, and we have four channels at least which have offshoots of this show. It is MasterChef itself and several shows which follow this.
Great Russian Bake Off?
Probably. I don't know.
My experience today.